and more. Offer ends July 1st. Visit staples.com/printbig for details. This is your sign to try Staples, where your prints are perfect guaranteed.
This is the KBLA Sports Minute with Ray Richardson.
Lakers coach Darvin Ham is planning a lineup change for game 2 against Denver. We'll have to wait until tip-off tonight to see what he does. Look for either 6'8 Jared Vanderbilt or 6'8 Rui Hachimura to be in the starting lineup. That means guards D'Angelo Russell or Dennis Schroeder, both starters in game 1, will be coming off the bench. The Lakers were out-rebounded 22-6 in the first quarter. 12 of those rebounds were pulled down by Nikola Jokic. The Lakers need to get a grip on their rebounding issues to avoid another fast start by the Nuggets. 5:30 tip-off on ESPN. Over in the East, the Miami Heat went into Boston and took game 1. 35 points, 7 assists, and 6 steals for Jimmy Butler. The Dodgers got a grand slam in the 7th inning from rookie outfielder James Outman to beat Minnesota. No debates, no speculation, just the info you need. That's your KBLA Sports Minute. I'm Ray Richardson. More news, opinions, and conversation when we come forward on KBLA Talk 1580.
All I need is one mic.
For KBLA Talk 1580, I'm Areva Martin with a KBLA editorial. Things are not always what they appear to be. A fundamental principle of our justice system is fairness. And fairness demands accurate and honest testimony, especially when that testimony is proffered from the U.S. government with its infinite resources and power. Accurate, honest, factual testimony appears to have been a no-show in the federal bribery trial of Mark Ridley Thomas. I followed every aspect of this case closely, and from day one, I've said the government's case was based on innuendo, speculation, and misinformation. With the latest developments, I guess I should reframe the misinformation to disinformation. The recent post-trial motions filed by Ridley Thomas's legal team revealed 3 false statements made by the prosecutor's star witness. Those documents also show that contrary to the government's claim and representations by some in the mainstream media, there was never an $8 million contract at issue, and Ridley Thomas received no benefit, monetary or otherwise, that would satisfy the elements of the crimes for which he was prosecuted and convicted. Our jury system sometimes gets it wrong, and when it does, it's up to the courts to right those wrongs, especially when a jury has been misled by a witness propped up by the prosecution. In a case of egregious misdirection like this one, it's up to the federal prosecutors to acknowledge their errors and for the media to do the same. After all, our judicial system is not based on winning at all costs, but on principles of fundamental fairness, truth, and justice. Principles that were apparently denied to Mark Ridley Thomas. For KBLA Talk 1580, I'm Areva Martin, and we welcome your comments.
She doesn't use a lot of me. KBLA Talk 1580. Time for our daily deep dive. That girl today, artist Shelley Bruce. She's a creative. She's based out of Long Beach. She's on a mission to serve the world's challenges, the greatest challenges, through spirituality, through poetry, painting, and community organizing. And here today to talk about what's going on at the Heart Department, which is a performance and event venue, one part rental venue, one part BIPOC community center at the intersection of arts, wellness, and social justice. I'm reading off the bio, okay? Not trying to get in your face about using the word
I'll
BIPOC.
I'll break it all down with all my eclectic stuff.
Shelly Bruce, good morning. Welcome.
Oh, good morning. I'm so honored and thrilled to be here.
It's great to have you in. So, I mean, we want to find out about you and all the great work that you're doing, but let's start at the beginning, which is the Heart Department.
Yes.
Your organization is in crisis.
It is. The Heart Department is a new community center. We've been around almost 11 months now, kind of birthed out of the need for Black and Indigenous and other groups of color needing event space. So I was offered, magically, really, a lease to a building in the Arts District in downtown Los Angeles about a year ago. And we've been funding and pushing and funding, but our process to secure our lease has escalated. So now we're needing to raise another 2 months of our deposit. We've been doing really well. I can tell about all the successes.
Yeah, and I want to talk about that.
Absolutely. We have a big fundraising push to do.
So, and the reason it's a crisis is because right now, if you aren't able to raise that 2 months deposit, you will not be continuing to exist in that space, right?
Yeah, I mean, we're solid right now. We have some good contractual short-term obligations, but it's not that long-term. We all know that when you're doing commercial work, you've got to get that 3-year, 5-year lease. And we really want to give our community that consistency and that security. So that's what we're working on right now.
Right. So what does that mean? Well, let's yes. talk about what it is. But what does that mean? Like, is it GoFundMe? Is it tons of fundraisers? Are you protesting? Are you?
I'm here for all of the
selling
above.
Cookies. Like
maybe some tea. Maybe we'll sell some tea. But no, we've been doing a GoFundMe. We do have a pretty strong business model. So we have folks renting our space. We just opened up a membership so people can co-work and pre-book event hours at our space. But we've also been working with different investors and grants. So we're doing all of the above to raise the funds that we need to provide for ourselves.
Okay. So it's a relatively new space.
Mm-hmm.
And you heard the conversation we're having about BIPOC. Folks mm-hmm. don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear people of color. They want to hear blackity, black, black. I get that. So why do you say BIPOC Community Center? And who is, because I'm looking
I'm
at your
so
Instagram and I see a lot of black people.
Yeah, you know, that's the thing. Sometimes when it's led by us, it's going to reflect us. But also BIPOC and black, it's like we're such a huge diaspora. Even on the way here, I was listening to your conversation and I said, okay, I understand different generations and folks sometimes not understanding how much our challenges overlap. And BIPOC really just stands for Black Indigenous People of Color. But we've definitely had retreats at our space that are Asian woman led. We've definitely had space where Latino folks, brown folks, there's so many folks, queer folks are working to use our space. One of my favorite community programs is actually happening this Saturday. It's an event called Iran Go Go. It's a group of Persians in Los Angeles who are advocating for the feminist revolution that's happening in Iran. So wanting to let folks know about the struggles of people in different parts of the world. So we are a space that really wants to celebrate various marginalized groups of people to ensure that their voices are heard and that they can have an affordable and safe space to express themselves.
Do you feel that pushback? Like the conversation that we were having, like, why can't it be a black space?
You know, not really. I feel like kind of my community, we're really used to some overlap. I think what naturally happens, because I'm a black woman and a lot of folks I work with are black, a majority of our work is black. But when it gets to being other cultures, I think our groups have really understood, because of the grassroots work they're doing, that our struggles are so very similar. They're not the same. And I also always down to talk about realms of privilege. You know, I've gone to college. I'm a fair-skinned black woman. I may have a different economic background than other folks in my community. Even within our own black community, there's levels of privilege and access that other people don't have that we have to be aware of. So whether it's other cultural communities or privilege within our own communities, I think it's really important to create space for those conversations to happen.
And so let's circle back a little bit to what the Heart Department is, because I just read what it says on Instagram, which they're under the Heart Department if you want to check for yourself. And your organization has pronouns.
Oh, my goodness. I mean, I just put that on there because it's on the gram. But the Heart Department spelled DEPT, where the Heart Department, DEPT.org. So that's the abbreviation. Some people have been saying the Heart Depot. It's not Home Depot. It's abbreviation for the Heart Department. But really, yeah, again, we are just a community space. I mean, it started out with this great venue that I was renting to raise money for my nonprofit at the time. And by developing a relationship with the building and the previous leaseholder and the owner, we were offered this space. So really, it's really evolved. Like, it's a totally brand new concept. I mean, the name didn't exist a year ago. The concept, the clientele, nothing existed a year ago. But fast forward 10 months, we can boast that 1,000 to 2,000 people walk through our building's doors every month. We've raised thousands of dollars for organizations that have come work with us. And we do a lot of cool programming, from wine music concerts, you got to come by sometime, to yoga, to sound bath, to poetry. You know, healing and wellness of what we call ourselves is very multifaceted, right? Sometimes dancing is wellness. Sometimes prayer is wellness. Sometimes therapy. So we really want to create a space that is at the intersection of arts, wellness, and social justice.
Right. And so what sounds maybe a little confusing, or what I'm maybe not understanding, is people rent the space, so you've got all kinds. Well, you know what? We'll talk about this when we come forward. Like, what part of it is your organization and what you do internally, and what part of it is space for rent? Come one, come all. We'll look at that and more when we come forward on KBLA Talk 1580.
KBLA Talk 1580 is an intervention. When we come forward, includes you. KBLA Talk 1580, turning pain into power.
Your health is important, so keep yourself and your family covered with Medi-Cal. Medi-Cal renewals will be happening soon, so if you have Medi-Cal, make sure you don't miss any important renewal information. If you've moved in the last 3 years, check and update your mailing address, email address, and phone number. Learn more at KeepMediCalCoverage.org. That's KeepMediCalCoverage.org. Paid for by the California Department of Healthcare Services.
At Lowe's, we're always bringing pros more ways to save. Right now, get a DeWalt cordless impact driver for just $99. Was $159. That's a savings of $60. Plus, you'll always save big on job lot quantities when buying select building supplies in bulk. Lowe's knows savings. Lowe's knows pros. Selection varies by location. While supplies last, discount taken at time of purchase. See associate for details. Valid through A2. Lowe's reserves the right to limit quantities.
Carrie, is this schedule the most updated?
There's a wedding season rush at Dr. Iona's dental practice.
We're fully booked this week. We can try and squeeze you in next Tuesday.
She needs a dental hygienist to unveil fresh smiles.
How long has 3 been under the UV light?
Indeed can help her hire great people fast.
I need Indeed.
Indeed you do. We instantly connect you with quality candidates whose resumes on Indeed match your job description. Visit Indeed.com/credit and get $75 towards your first sponsored job. Terms and conditions apply.
Mom's early Alzheimer's diagnosis was hard to take.
And when I left the oven on, we decided together that it was time to see a doctor and make a plan.
Early detection gave us more time to seek out information and support as a family.
If you or your family are noticing changes, it could be Alzheimer's. Talk about seeing a doctor together. For more information, visit alz.org/timetotalk. A message from the Alzheimer's Association and the Ad Council.
Attention LA seniors and persons with disabilities. You may qualify for generous discounts on your LADWP bills through the Lifeline program. It's easy to join Lifeline, and your enrollment may qualify you to receive a new energy-efficient refrigerator and valuable rebates up to $225 on room air conditioners through the Cool LA program. So if you're a senior or have a disability, sign up today at ladwp.com/lifeline. That's ladwp.com/lifeline.
Thanks for waking up with Dominique DePrima on KBLA Talk 1580.
I do appreciate you, and you're welcome into the conversation always, 800-920-1580. Talking with Shelley Bruce, and she is a business person and also a community activist, in the sense that the Heart Department, which is DEPT, as you point out, right, the Heart Dept helmed.org is both a community center and a business.
Absolutely.
So tell me how that works and, you know, what side of what does what.
Absolutely. I mean, I realize just that even being a concept is something we developed, and I think it's one of the most important parts of what we do. 3 years ago, I started a grassroots kind of movement organization called Day of Healing. So about 2.5 years, I was doing wellness and arts programming in from Venice to Leimert to Santa Monica to Long Beach. And I realized, okay, this is cool, y'all, and I want people to get things for free, but how do I fund this? So I created a business model. So in collaboration with my movement, we started a concert called The Healer, and we were doing this concert at this beautiful venue in the Arts District. Fast forward a year later, they offered for me to rent that space. So what I realized is that with so much nonprofit work outside of grants and all of the bureaucracy we've got to do sometimes to fund these movements, I said, let's create a business structure that pairs with our community work. So in the building and of itself, as it's grown, we've definitely had our regular clients. We've had baby showers, even the National Black or the Black Journalists Association in LA had their holiday party at our space last December. We rent it out for various clients, right? But on those days that we're not renting it, that means that the Village of Mothers, a group of Black moms with their toddlers, they can come on a donation basis and use the space for their gathering, for their potluck. So the model is to create a consistent business structure that also allows nonprofits and community organizations to have resources that they need.
So you're an artist, you do painting, you do poetry. Where do you get this business foundation? Because seriously, a lot of artists and also community organizers just do what they do. And the reason we don't have the spaces, the reason we don't have the platforms is because that business structure is missing.
Oh, yeah. I mean, sometimes I just feel like I'm a Black girl figuring it out in LA and in community. Probably a couple things. In wellness, I think one of the things we've learned through all the orgs I've worked with is what's sustainable? What feels good? What's the point of me trying to provide yoga or meditation for someone if I'm struggling over here financially or if it's hard to buy the things we need? So I started to figure out, well, what's the solution? Okay, it's going to cost. Okay, we got to pay everybody so that they can make the time to come. So that really pushed me into business. Also, I've got an amazing mom, an amazing dad, an amazing mentorship community that I've watched and have supported me in developing these things. But at the end of the day, being offered the lease to this building was really purely based on relationships and community work. So I feel very grateful that we were even offered the opportunity to rent such an amazing space. I can't wait to even talk to people about that and for them to go online and see us because the place is gorgeous. But it is such a beautiful home that I feel like our community deserves. You know, we deserve to have these beautiful places. And it's cool to turn it into a business that can provide for different organizations.
So the business is actually supporting the community work of the community organization.
Yeah, it's definitely a two-part and overlap. You know, there's nonprofits who come in and they host their idea of a party or a business, you know, model so that they can raise money for their organization. So it definitely overlaps quite a bit.
So let's talk about that intersection of arts, wellness, and social justice.
Absolutely.
I feel like your generation, and I'm assuming based on how you look, because I have no idea what what generation you're in, but I feel like younger folks have more of a commitment to the self-care and well-being piece as part of our liberation, really.
Absolutely. I definitely feel like the new work of activism is wellness. You know, I think I'm 34, so I guess I'm in that millennial, you know, pocket.
Millennial,
yeah. And we work with a lot of Gen Z folks too, but I feel that in my generation, mental health has come up so strong. And who in the world couldn't understand that too when 2020 came along? I think the whole world got hit with physical ailments, mental ailments, really having to go within and look at ourselves. And so I think our generation is realizing, okay, the pressures of the world or capitalism or government or all these things are so intense. How am I going to deal with that? How am I going to feel good in my spirit and feel good about myself? People are finding meditation. They're finding yoga. They're finding all kinds of different practices. And so even within that, before I really got into wellness, maybe 5-6 years ago, I grew up as an artist. I painted since I was 13. I went to Cal Poly Pomona. I studied, you know, so I was in the arts field. But I always found that, well, why am I there? It's because it's what I love. It's because it's what feeds me. It's what makes me heal through all my emotions and my processes. So I think being at the intersections of art, wellness and social justice really is a really powerful overlap I'm seeing in a lot of work now, because people realize for us to be well, for us to move forward, we have to do things that we love. We have to use art and tools to communicate the revolution. I think one of my favorite quotes is a Toti Cade Bambara quote. It's like, it is the artist's duty to make the revolution irresistible. You know, and it's like using art to communicate these important ideas and to create a world that we all want to live in.
Yeah. And moving away from this idea, I mean, Audre Lorde says it, but moving away on a more mass level from this idea that somehow taking care of ourselves is frivolous or that it is silly and not connected to progress for Black people or progress for women.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I think as a person and as a community organizer, I'm always healing through guilt. You know, it's like, oh, I could be doing more. Why am I not doing this? And then we have the social media world. You get online and there's a million likes on all these things. It's like you could look outside yourself and see endless things of what you still got to do. But I realized in my journey through going to therapy for the first time since 2017, or, you know, practicing meditation more, I realized that guilt is an understandable emotion, but it's not a healthy emotion that's going to help me move through things. And so I realized that I have to heal through these things to be a better leader, to be in better service to myself and to my community.
So what does that mean? This is an ongoing conversation right. that I have, because I'm a health enthusiast. Mm-hmm. I'm not a millennial, but I'm a health enthusiast, mm-hmm. and I always have been. And I always, you know, get the side eye from a lot of people. Oh, you're supposed to be committed to the movement, but you over here in the gym. Yeah, that's mm-hmm. what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm going to keep doing. But I mean, what does it really mean, you know, to commit to self-care beyond, you know, some kind of surface understanding of what that is, you know, eating vegetables or drinking more water. Yeah, okay.
Oh, my favorite was when I first became vegan, people were like, what's that bird food you're eating? Like, what's going on over here?
I'm not vegan. I was for a while. And I remember that well. Oh, you got more celery?
Yeah. I call myself a flexitarian. Okay. And I like to say I'm vegan except for oxtails because I'm Jamaican. But balance, right? So how am I going to wake up, go to work, get the things done, serve, read, if I don't feel good inside, if I'm not feeling confident, and so or just good in my body? So I think our generation is really about, you know, putting our bodies first as much as we can, putting our minds first. I actually had kind of a tough work day yesterday, and my coworker, she's like, hey, make some art, express it, get it out. And I was resistant at first. I was like, I don't think that's going to help. Then an hour later, I was writing. The hour later, I was making a video and just expressing myself. And it just emptied that out of me. So I realized that I got the clarity and the downloads or whatever it was because I took the time to take care of myself and I took the time to express myself. So I feel that even the reason I even started this work, why we have a heart department, or even before when it was Day of Healing, my grassroots organization doing protests, I felt so traumatized as a Black person in Los Angeles. I'm kind of in LA now. I was in Long Beach for a while. But when I lived in Long Beach, there was, you know, tanks going down the street. There's protests happening. I'd been involved in activism. So as much as I knew I needed to be out there, I knew I wanted to be involved, I felt kind of re-traumatized. So I realized that, and a lot of my colleagues realized that, yo, we need to go out to the park. We need to be by the ocean. We need to wear white. We need to do some different things that ground us and whatever practices feel good to our spirit, because when we're grounded, we're thinking about the world we want to live in. Yeah, we go out in the street to fight for what's happening, but that's also part of the world we don't want to experience. I think equally have to pair our work with fighting against what's wrong, but also experiencing and building what we feel like would be right and what would actually be healthy for us.
Because my observation over the years, I mean, if you go back to, you know, Malcolm X, Dr. Martin Luther King, whatever, Ida B. Wells, they all seem to be pretty fit and doing what they do in their spiritual space to be able to survive in that pressure cooker that they were in. But then I think that if you get to a little more recent times, I see a lot of our community activists and leaders not investing in their well-being.
I think it's hard, and we're
losing folks. You know, I think of people like Muhammad Nazarene of Recycling Black Dollars and Lou Danzler of the Challengers Boys and Girls Club and all these folks that we lost, you know. I mean, yeah, he was up in age, but even my own dad, he was 79 when he passed. But why not? Why couldn't he be 89 or 99, you know? And I think there's for certain progressive activists, there It's like go hard or go home. And if you're not all in these streets, in you know, working, you're not authentic to change, to revolution, or to progress.
It's so hard. You know, I think the world of social media and the internet that we maybe didn't have 30, 40 years ago is you have access to see everything all the time.
20 years ago.
20 years ago, right?
It's not like it is now. Yeah.
Right. It just exponentially growing, right? Yeah. And AI and all these things, super overwhelming. So we have new challenges, right? Mental health for teens and young people is higher than ever. Suicide rates are high because there's so much pressure and information and all the research that's done on how unhealthy the cell phone usage is. So even though there, I think, are activists who feel that pressure to go hard because we have deeper political and other global issues than we've ever had. At the same time, I actually know there's a lot of organizers who are like, look, y'all, I'm taking a break. I'm taking a day off. I'm taking a nap. I'm taking a mental health day. My favorite Twitter, one of my favorite Twitter pages, I think it's the Nap Ministry. There's a woman, she even has a book out, and she talks about her whole Twitter feed is like, Black women need rest. Black folks need rest. I'm not going to be pushed to my edges. And there's so many people resonating with that because we shouldn't be activists who get out there and fight till we break down. Because then how can, again, we, again, reimagine the world we want to be living and build that world for the next generation? But how can we even enjoy the present moment? There's a lot of days even in the work I'm doing where, okay, we're hustling. I had a 15-hour day because we had two back-to-back clients. But the next day, I'm starting at 11. Or I'm going to the meditation garden to sit under a tree for an hour. But even that hour recharges me just enough. So I think we're all recognizing the pressures of the world and the internet and all these challenges we're able to see. But also I think we're pushing back by healing. I think we're pushing back by taking care of ourselves.
I mean, I do think that the younger generation in this is influencing older generations. And this idea that by grinding, whatever it is, whether it's your hustle or your activism, you're taking on the predatory capitalist model of, you know, and being your own boss and working yourself to death.
Right. I mean, I think about, I grew up Christian. I guess I call myself more spiritual now, but I think I still so resonate and appreciate my upbringing because I had prayer and I had meditation in that way. But I also knew that I didn't know what therapy was till I was 27. And I think, you know, people have been saying praying is not enough. And it's so important in our communities and our whatever our beliefs are, religious beliefs are so important. We also have to understand that there's other things that maybe we weren't raised with, tools we didn't have. You know, in my community, we talk a lot about conflict resolution, which is why I was loving listening to you on the way here, because what is healing if we don't get to a place where it's a little messy and we got to clean it up? What is work if we don't recognize an issue and we find a graceful way to hopefully navigate or mend that situation? So for me, I didn't have these tools. I know my parents didn't have these tools. So we talk about inner child healing and parenting ourselves and all those things, but it's really about, what are those tools that didn't exist? Let's blaze trails there. Because if we can learn to be more gentle with each other, if we can learn to take care of ourselves, I know that when I'm rested and happy and confident, I do much better work for my community.
Yeah. I mean, there's that idea of a point of diminishing returns. And I think all of us could get more familiar with that, where you think you're working and then you look up and nothing got done. We're about to go into news, traffic, and sports. Shelley Bruce is my guest. You are welcome to join the conversation. We're talking about the Heart Department. We're talking about the intersection of arts, wellness, and social justice. All that is on the table. It's KBLA Talk 1580.
More of First Things First with Dominique DePrima when we come forward.
I'm Mike Moore. Here's the latest from the Black Information Network. A date is set for the pretrial hearing of a former Louisville, Kentucky police officer involved in African-American Breonna Taylor's death. Brett Hankinson fired multiple shots through Taylor's apartment back in 2020 and is facing civil rights violations. Florida Governor Ron DeSantis reportedly will officially enter the 2024 presidential race next week. The Washington Post reporting that two people familiar with the Republican governor's plan say DeSantis will kick off his campaign for the GOP nomination as he gathers top fundraisers in Miami. A book publisher, authors, parents, and a free speech group are suing a Florida school district for banning books. The Escambia County School District pulled 10 books related to race and the LGBTQ community. And that's the latest. I'm Mike Moore from your 24/7 news source, the Black Information Network and BINnews.com.
Staples Print and Marketing Services helps small business print big. Now get $15 off signs, banners, and posters when you spend $75 or more. Offer ends July 1st. Visit staples.com/printbig for details. This is your sign to try Staples, where your prints are perfect guaranteed.
This is the KBLA Sports Minute with Ray Richardson.
Lakers coach Darvin Ham is planning a lineup change for Game 2 against Denver. We'll have to wait until tip-off tonight to see what he does. Look for either 6'8 Jared Vanderbilt or 6'8 Rui Hachimura to be in the starting lineup. That means guards D'Angelo Russell or Dennis Schroeder, both starters in Game 1, will be coming off the bench. The Lakers were out-rebounded 22-6 in the first quarter. 12 of those rebounds were pulled down by Nikola Jokic. The Lakers need to get a grip on their rebounding issues to avoid another fast start by the Nuggets. 5:30 tip-off on ESPN. Over in the East, the Miami Heat went into Boston and took Game 1. 35 points, 7 assists, and 6 steals for Jimmy Butler. The Dodgers got a grand slam in the 7th inning from rookie outfielder James Outman to beat Minnesota. No debates, no speculation, just the info you need. That's your KBLA Sports Minute. I'm Ray Richardson. More news, opinions, and conversation when we come forward on KBLA Talk 1580.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States of America.
The story of Emmett Till and his mother is a story of a family's promise and loss in a nation's reckoning with hate, violence, and abuse of power. It's a story that was seared into our memory and our conscience, the nation's conscience, when Mrs. Till insisted that an open casket for her murdered and maimed 14-year-old son. She said, "Let the people see what I've seen." The reason the world saw what she saw was because of another hero in this story, the Black Press, Jet Magazine, the Chicago Defender, and other Black radio and newspapers were unflinching and brave in making sure America saw what she saw. Ida B. Wells once said, and I quote, "The way to right wrongs is to turn the light of truth upon the wrongs."
Turning the light of truth upon the wrongs. We're unapologetically progressive. KBLA Talk 1580, and we don't black down.
Calling all small business owners, entrepreneurs, and startups. Vermont Slauson Economic Development Corporation is your one-stop shop for the resources and tools you need to take your business to the next level. VSEDC is a community-based nonprofit and CDFI organization recognized for decades of technical and entrepreneurial assistance to South LA small businesses, startups, and entrepreneurs for 40 years. VSEDC provides training workshops and your very own business coach, and these services are all free. That's right, these services are free. Business coaches are standing by at their South LA Business Source Center or their Watts Business Source Center. Visit their website at vsedc.org or call them now at 323-752-2335. That's Vermont Slauson Economic Development Corporation at 323-753-2335.
The Black Hollywood Education and Resource Center's 30th annual Sisters Are Doing It For Themselves Short Film Showcase, May 19th through the 21st at the Directors Guild of America. Opening night celebration hosted by actress Wendy Raquel Robinson with special guest, director, actress, and choreographer Debbie Allen. Come out and celebrate emerging Black women filmmakers. See dynamic films, hear great panels, careers in Hollywood, directors on directing, and more. Don't miss Sisters Are Doing It For Themselves Short Film Showcase, May 19th through the 21st. For more information, go to bherc.org or call 323-957-4656. 323-957-4656.
Broadcasting live from Lombard Park, USA. Welcome back to your home for unapologetically progressive radio, KBLA Talk 1580.
I'm Dominique DePrima, and hopefully you know that, but we're having a conversation with Shelley Bruce. She is the founder of the Heart Department, which is Heart and then DEPT, because I guess department is really long when you
spell
it out.
That's our trademark, or we're abbreviating.
Okay. The Heart Department, which is, you know, a space which is a community center, and it's available for rent for folks that everything you said, from baby showers to community-based organizations doing their own work.
Mm-hmm. I feel like real estate and land is such a big topic, isn't it? You know, yeah. And people need space. They need access to space. And hey, we're in LA. It's one of the most expensive cities in the country. But when we band together as community, we can really share that. So yeah, we rent for private clients for filming. We've even had clients like, I think we had an HBO-sponsored Grammy party at our event
nice.
A few months back. That was cool. But it was also with a small black business called Waves Management. So in the time that we're not renting to private clients, there's also nonprofits who need to host their fundraisers. There's groups that need to have their meetings. And so as the Heart Department, we're able to create consistency for various organizations, and not just black organizations, but organizations from various communities in need.
It's the Heart and then DEPT.org. And I'm on the website right now. The space is quite beautiful. Just looking at some of the different kinds of events.
Can I tell you a little bit about the space?
Please
too?
Do. Yes.
Okay. This building is so magical, y'all. It's a two-story historic building in the Arts District, which is like, you know, east of downtown. We're right next to the 6th Street Bridge. So we're sisters with East LA. And it's a building that was built in 1924. So it's got original floors and brick and windows. It used to be a garment factory, but over the years, the owner converted it. And like many buildings in that neighborhood, it's turned into loft and warehouse space. So our upstairs is our really beautiful, pristine rental space. And downstairs, we've actually sectioned it off into different offices and studios for different offices for artists to rent. So it's a pretty multifaceted building. And so far, we've had small events from 15 people. We've had up to 300 plus people in our building renting out the whole, both floors. So it's a pretty cool space. I highly recommend for you to check it out on Instagram or check out the website to see it.
Same thing on Instagram, the Heart and then DEPT. I see, you know, smiling boys
yeah.
exhibit Black Boy Joy.
We do it so many different events. Smiling Boys was cool. That was an exhibition with an artist from London named K. Rufai, Nigerian guy. He came out to LA for a couple months and he brought his photography. And then on top of his photography of young black men in London, he worked at a school in Watts with about 20 different 10th graders at a high school, young black men, to talk about emotional wellness. So his work he's been doing in London, he came all the way to LA to do here. It was a colleague artist friend of mine from
wow.
over the years. So there's so many ways that artists are expressing themselves. And I also just love that he brought those students, he brought his boys from Watts to the Arts District. They had meditation and they had hugs and laughed and they were free doing some freestyling, I think, that day. So there's so many ways that arts, education, all these things have been used at our space.
I see Walk Good LA's Black Men's Healing Circle.
Absolutely.
I see, wine music concert.
Mm-hmm.
Which you kind of mentioned on the way in, but so many different kinds of events.
Right, right. And we're a new business. We're a new space. So I'm learning and figuring out what exactly we are. The Heart Department didn't exist a year ago, but over the months we've gained different clients and also different organizations. So Wine Music would be considered more of a client that has been renting our space every last Saturday for a classical music concert paired with wine. Super cool. Also independently run by these artists and classical composers. But then we also have things like Walk Good LA, who's also used our space for their Black Men's Healing Circle. My favorite group is Village of Mothers. That's like the group of moms that meets, and they're actually hosting a fundraiser in our space in June. We also have a Haitian day party that's happening monthly now, too. We have a group called Artivists. They combine art and activism. They're supporting the Iranian movement right now. So I know I'm rolling down a whole list of things, but the space is really turning into a nice monthly spot for a lot of different groups to do their thing.
And we started out with the inciting incident, which is that
yes.
after being offered the lease and keeping up with those monthly payments, you now have to come up with 2 months' deposit.
Right.
And you want to keep the space. It sounds like you're in motion to do so. You're doing all things necessary and
yeah.
possible, but we are asking the community to support right now.
Absolutely. You know, the uniqueness of our story is, hey, first of all, that this young black woman got offered a lease to a building in downtown. That was huge. Then the second thing was we fundraised as a community just enough to move in, but it really only got us started for the short term. And the other thing that happened is when we first started, we were only leasing the top floor. So we made it for the first 4 or 5 months. We were doing good, but in January, the bottom floor became available, and we said, kind of a rock and a hard place, but also an opportunity. Hey, if we don't take this, we might lose everything, but hey, let's go for it. So our business
wow.
actually doubled in January.
That's
two
crazy.
Floors, double staff, double everything. So now we're fundraising to secure a lease for a bigger a much bigger goal than we realized.
Right. But if you wouldn't have done it, who knows what would have happened with the bottom? They might have rented out the whole building to someone else, and it could be history. One of the things I love right now, you said, you know, we're talking about gentrification and the issue of space and housing being so intense in Southern California, is that, you know, I see more and more people, Black people, creating spaces, creating businesses, even in a time when we're supposed to be shrinking, all over LA. It feels like this is almost part of that.
You know, I think 100% it sure is. And I also want to talk about it in the realm of abundance and resources, not in some floaty way of abundance. Our communities are abundant. I wouldn't be in this position running the Heart Department if it wasn't for so many beautiful people who came together to host things. That's our client base. So whether it's the Compton Community Garden that just saved itself because they had to raise $500,000 in a month to secure their property, or it's Plant Chica, which is a beautiful green space in mid-city that has to fundraise right now because they might lose their lease. There's a wonderful group called Sovereign LA. There's Be Elevated Wellness in Venice. There's also the Heart Department. These are all BIPOC or Black run spaces that are working to host community and wellness programming, but the market is intense. So even in my position, even though I've known, you know, what we've needed to fundraise, it's been hard to, A, from our community and generational poverty and or generational wealth, find folks with the right resources to help us, but even just keep up with the market. You know, it was one thing when we started to rent one floor. We did that. We built a model and raised it. But when we had to double to two floors, definitely a great opportunity, but also a tough place. So here we are now proving it after 10 months of showing how many people come here, how many groups use this space, how much it's needed, but also having to play the real estate game. So I think the biggest thing about this is whether it's Bruce's Beach, when we talk about historically Black communities getting run out of their neighborhoods, we have an opportunity right now to support Black-run spaces like the Heart Department. So I'm just really, you know, it's a challenging moment, but I'm also really proud and excited because community banding together. I had a $5,000 donation on Monday. I've had so many different groups come to offer fundraisers. I still got a ways to go. I still got to raise like another $35,000. But with all the community coming together, I feel so much hope and I know that it's possible.
And how do we support? I mean, whether we have $5 or $5,000 or the whole $35K, how do we step up?
A volunteer hour, we love it. Well, you can find us on GoFundMe. We're crowdfunding there. You can search Save the Heart Department, and that's DEPT. We have theheartdepartment.org. You can rent our space. We also started this really cool membership that I'm proud of, so people can co-work a couple days a week. They can pre-book rental hours and have access to our space. We only have 100 membership slots, but we've been starting to sell our first few. So we're really excited to offer various streams of revenue. Yeah, it might be a business, but that business is also supporting the community and supporting community spaces. So
it's really like a socially innovative business model that you've created. How do I become a member and what do I get from my membership?
Oh, absolutely. Well, on the Heart Department Instagram or on our website, there is a link for the THD Collective. We're calling it the Heart Department Collective. We have three membership levels. They're super cute. They're called Cousins, Chosen Family, and Soul Family. So at different levels, you can invest to get co-working access a couple days a week, free event tickets to our community programming, and highly discounted rental hours. Some of our larger packages come with hours. So if you were going to go to any venue on Pier Space for 7 hours, it might cost you $2,000 to rent it. Well, you can book a membership with the Heart Department, and that $2,000 will pay for the whole year, and you'll get access to renting our space. So definitely go on the website to learn more. You can always DM us, ask us questions, email us. But we basically, like the Soho House or WeWork or wherever, designed a community membership model. I don't want us to be exclusive and bougie and too elitist, but I do want to create an investment way for the community to support the space and also get access to the resource.
The Heart Department, I think it's important for folks, if you can, to support, just because we, like you said, we are abundant in so many ways. And I really feel this is a personal journey for me, but I think it's a personal journey for a lot of us, which is moving away from that deprivation model and stepping into an abundance model, stepping into an empowered model. We know what we don't want. We know how to protest what we don't want. We also know how to pivot to what we do want. And I think, you know, people say I have on rose-colored glasses. Yeah, I like my rose-colored glasses, but they're not rose-colored glasses that don't understand the obstacles. It's saying I'm going to focus on what I want, not what I don't want, and I'm going to make that conscious decision. So want to find out a little bit more about how you might be able to support just by showing up at some events, what's on the calendar at the Heart Department? That's next on KBLA Talk 1580.
She's reclaiming her time on KBLA Talk 1580. More First Things First with Dominic DePrima when we come forward.
You know those cigarette butts that you see every day? They're made of microplastics and they line our streets and waterways. On California beaches, they're the number one plastic you'll find. Over 35 years, cleanups have collected millions combined. But no matter where you see them, they're all getting smaller, eventually leaching into our food, our air, our water. The tobacco industry's to blame for all of the harm that they do. For the harm to the people we love, and the harm to you too. Learn more at undo.org.
Fantasia. With special guest Joe, Friday, May 26th at Microsoft Theater in Los Angeles, and Saturday, May 27th at Toyota Arena in Ontario. Fantasia, live in concert. Tickets on sale now at FantasiaOfficial.com. Don't miss Fantasia with special guest Joe.
If your Medi-Cal is ending, Cover California is here to help. Cover California is a service from the state that helps you get affordable health insurance. In many cases, at no cost to you, just like with Medi-Cal. We have quality health plans and we'll help you every step of the way to get the one that works for you and your family. So, if you're no longer eligible for Medi-Cal, check out Cover California. We'll keep you covered. Learn more at coveredca.com.
All I need is one mic.
For KBLA Talk 1580, I'm Areva Martin with a KBLA editorial. Things are not always what they appear to be. A fundamental principle of our justice system is fairness. And fairness demands accurate and honest testimony, especially when that testimony is proffered from the U.S. government with its infinite resources and power. Accurate, honest, factual testimony appears to have been a no-show in the federal bribery trial of Mark Ridley Thomas. I followed every aspect of this case closely, and from day one, I've said the government's case was based on innuendo, speculation, and misinformation. With the latest developments, I guess I should reframe the misinformation to disinformation. The recent post-trial motions filed by Ridley Thomas's legal team revealed three false statements made by the prosecutor's star witness. Those documents also show that contrary to the government's claim and representations by some in the mainstream media, there was never an $8 million contract at issue, and Ridley Thomas received no benefit, monetary or otherwise, that would satisfy the elements of the crimes for which he was prosecuted and convicted. Our jury system sometimes gets it wrong, and when it does, it's up to the courts to right those wrongs, especially when a jury has been misled by a witness propped up by the prosecution. In a case of egregious misdirection like this one, it's up to the federal prosecutors to acknowledge their errors and for the media to do the same. After all, our judicial system is not based on winning at all costs, but on principles of fundamental fairness, truth, and justice. Principles that were apparently denied to Mark Ridley Thomas. For KBLA Talk 1580, I'm Areva Martin, and we welcome your comments.
KBLA Talk 1580, where hate meets a scholarly match.
And it's scholarly matches you, 800-920-1580. We're talking with Shelley Bruce. She's behind the Heart Department, which is Heart DEPT on Instagram and heartdept.org. You're an artist, though. I don't want you to leave here without, you know, talking about your own art.
Sure.
How can we find your work? How can we support what you're doing?
I mean, not to bring it back around, but I feel that I have thrown my whole self into the Heart Department. It's been the most beautiful creative experience to birth something from nothing. But I am a poet. I am a painter. I've been painting and doing poetry for about 17 years. Went to college for it at Cal Poly. I worked at CAM, the California African American Museum, and I recently published my first poetry album. You can find it on Spotify and all those things. You can look me up, artist Shelley Bruce. The album's called Heaven Here. And I have some paintings of my own at the Heart Department. I use it as a studio when I'm not going away at the emails in the office. So you can find me as artist Shelley Bruce on Instagram.
Well, too bad we didn't know we could have played a cut off of your... next time.
Next time,
Heaven
please.
Here on Spotify.
I got
Spotify.
Lots to share.
Artist Shelley Bruce. Okay. Let's go to Quamel calling from Gardena. Hi, Quamel.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure that Shelley Bruce feels the love and that you, Mr. Pena, feel the love. I mean, he's work streets right now, but as soon as I heard Shelley Bruce on the radio, I was like, oh my Lord.
Hey, Quamel, I know exactly who that is.
He's the one who hit me up on Instagram and said, check this out.
Oh, thank you.
Which led to me going into your DMs and saying, how can we help?
Oh, he's amazing. He's an incredible poet, and I've actually been a feature at one of his open mics. He does a wonderful... You still doing that open mic in Long Beach?
Yes, I am, and we have the one-year anniversary, but it's not about me today. It's about you, Shelley, and the whole Heart Department. I want to see that space survive, and, you know, as they say on the station, when we fight, we win. So I'm going to throw it back to y'all.
Oh, you're amazing. Thank you, brother.
Yeah, I appreciate that, Quamel. And, you know, if you can't find me... It's easier to find me on Instagram than on the phone. Just a pro tip. The Prima Radio or KBLA 1580 and, of course, the Heart Department, Heart DEPT. So what's coming up? Actually, we'll focus on that when we come forward. But give me one sample of something that's coming up soon that we might want to check
This weekend's going to be fun. We're doing activism and art on Saturday with a group called Artivists. They're celebrating the Iranian feminist revolution with a film screening 4 to 8 p.m. And then on Sunday, we've got a Haitian day party with some Haitian food, some Haitian music. Apparently, it's Haitian Flag Day, so you can attend that party. I think it starts like 4 or 5 o'clock, too. All that information's on our Instagram at the Heart Department. That's DEPT. So find us on Instagram or online.
All right. When we come forward, you know, maybe you'll share a couple more things, events that are coming up at your space, the Heart Department. Remind us how we can help you and whatever thought you want to leave us with.
Absolutely.
That's next. KBLA Talk 1580.
A safe place to go loud. Loud. A great place for progressive politics. KBLA Talk 1580.
The pandemic may be over, but many Angelenos could be at risk of losing the place they call home. It's important to know your rights as a residential renter in the city of LA. Did you know eviction protection still exists for unpaid COVID-19 rental debt that was due before March 31st, 2023? And that you have 5 days to respond to an eviction notice, also known as an unlawful detainer. Learn more about your rental rights at housing.lacity.org. Be informed, be protected, be at home.
When you're young, life is full of choices. Don't let opioids like highly addictive and deadly fentanyl take away your life and your choices with just one wrong pill. Addiction is a disease that can affect anyone at any age, but there is a choice to get help for this disease. Find medically proven treatment options, including virtual, at choosemat.org.
Come join us for a celebration of community, culture, and healing at the I Love Myself Festival, Sunday, May 21st from 11 a.m. until 4 p.m. at the Outdoor Pavilion of the Baldwin Hills Crenshaw Mall. Yoga, meditation, food, vendors, a kids zone, and a special panelist segment featuring Samantha Smith, Dee Smoke, and Ebony Davis. Performances by Wilson, Skylar Ray, Divas of Compton, Iman Europe, Kalan For Real, and Eric Bellinger. It's all going down Sunday, May 21st at the Outdoor Pavilion of the Baldwin Hills Crenshaw Mall from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. Let's come together for a day of fun, celebration, and healing. For more details, contact Project Pitt on social media or text 323-448-5770. The I Love Myself Festival in celebration of Mental Health Awareness Month is a free event for community healing and culture. May 21st from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. at the Baldwin Hills Crenshaw Mall.
The conversation continues right now. Dominique DePrima on First Things First.
Yes, the KBLA delegation is stepping up to show some love to the Heart Department. Shelley Bruce is joining us, artist Shelley Bruce on Spotify, and the Heart DEPT on Instagram, theheartdept.org. You can donate, save the Heart Department on GoFundMe. What else do you want to share that's coming up?
You know, even though times are very hard for a lot of people, and we know that, and it's really hard for me to even crowdfund, we have to, as a community, take those fiscal steps to invest together, because when we work together, we have collective wealth. I know things may be hard individually, but I think the Heart Department is a perfect example of collective value. So when you invest in us, you donate to us, you rent with us, you are helping me provide space for yoga, for sound bath, for art, for poetry. And so I know people may spend $500 on Beyonce tickets or whatever other thing, but if you spend $500 with us, it's going to go a long way. So please invest in us as a space. We've proven it the last 10 months. We plan to prove it for years to come. So we need you right now so we can save our space.
All right. Well, you know, you said that very succinctly, which means you have some more time.
Can I do a little poem?
Yeah.
Real quick?
Awesome. I love that. Yeah.
Okay. I saw it from another show of yours. All right. Let me see. This is a piece of my poem called Light Seed. It's on my album, on all the things, Spotify. The piece I want to share is, I know sometimes it feels like you're the only one who survived, with a million stories scribed in native tongue behind your eye, as if you could possibly remain this small, as if you could be contained by vessel, measureless you, as if our ancestors didn't strive and survive so that we could be. In Los Angeles, we actually kind of occupy Mexican soil. Nos sentamos en tierras indígenas. And their people, farm workers, have often said, they tried to bury us, but forgot we are seeds. Sister reminds, all you gotta do is believe, and we've built everything on this, thought to word to action. Life is action. Life is a dare at how legendary you could be, so I became the full moon at midnight. It is time to be raised from our dead, for any darkness can be canceled by one light seed. Ashe.
Lovely. Really nice. Yeah.
Oh, the claps.
Miles with the applause. All
snap. We are all so powerful. We're all leaders. We're all lights. Even if it's our everyday job or some big leadership position, I think we all have such an immense impact. And I'm really grateful I get to be an artist, a community organizer, and do that work every day. So I'm really excited to be here. Thank you so much to this show. I can't tell you how important it is to promote our story. I want the world to know the Heart Department exists. I want LA to know the Heart Department exists, so other people like me can have an opportunity to share their work.
Yeah, well, I think it's really important what you're doing in so many ways. The social justice piece, the business piece too, and actually literally making space, right, for artists, for activists, for everybody in between, mamas, you know, that is what we need. We need space to do the things we do, literally, psychologically, artistically, and you're literally doing that. And I know it ain't easy. So I want to thank you for doing that. And that's why when Kwamel brought that to my attention, I was like, oh yeah, this is what we're here for at KBLA. Mm-hmm. We're here to help people that are creating space, that are innovating, and that are doing stuff that folks don't know about, that we need to know about, because I think we're too quick to say we ain't ish and forget, or maybe don't even know all of the amazing things that people really are doing.
Yeah, we are the originals. We're the trendsetters. You know, we may be going through hard things, but we're so abundant, and I feel privileged and honored, and I know I'm privileged and blessed to do this kind of work, even though it's the hardest things to do. Ooh, I'm tired. It's the most beautiful things. It's worth it every day. So I challenge everyone, go find the Heart Department, come pull up on us for an event, go online. I promise you it's really magical, and our community deserves it. That's the thing I say all the time. I'll close with is, our community deserves good things, luxury, wellness, art. We deserve these things, and that actually what fuels us for everything else.
Yeah. Thank you. All right. Tavis Smiley is up next. I'm Dominique DePrima. History is now, and we're making it together. Until tomorrow, be artistic, be safe, be well. One love.
KBLA 1580 Santa Monica.
I'm Mike Moore. Here's the latest. Breonna Taylor's death. Brett Hankinson fired multiple shots through Taylor's apartment back in 2020 and is facing civil rights violations. Florida Governor